Good morning, everyone. If you're here for the LNC webinar, you're in the right place. I assure you, we're going to get started in about 1 minute to give everyone a chance to join. All right, well, once again, welcome everyone. This is the November FIA LNC webinar. Today's law firm host is White & Case. I believe this is the first time White & Case has done a webinar with us, so we're excited to welcome the team. Today's topic is digital assets. I was checking our webinar archive, and I think it's been about a year to the day since we did a webinar dedicated to the regulation of digital assets. And today we're going to be doing a comparative exploration looking at the U.S. And from my vantage point, maybe not all that much to report, rather frustratingly, in terms of developments here in the U.S., but I'll let Ed and the team tell me if they disagree with that. And lots of developments in the EU since that last annual check-in. So I will quickly turn it over to Ed, who I believe is up for, first, but I always like to give the housekeeping items at the beginning in case you're new to the webinar series. So if you're tuning in today and seeking CLE, we have been approved for an hour of CLE today from Virginia, and you will get a CLE certificate from Beth shortly after the conclusion of today's program. Just please be sure you have to dial in for the full hour to get the credit. And you should have already received a copy of today's slide deck via email from Beth. If you haven't, please shoot her a note at bthompson@fia.org. We encourage questions, and you can pose them to our panelists using the Q&A button that should appear at the bottom of your toolbox in the Zoom platform on your screen. And we will be recording today's webinar. Just give us about 24 hours to get it up on our website. It will appear in the webinar section at fia.org. So with that intro, I think, Ed, you're up first. I'll let you give some introductions to the team, if that's your preference, and you have the reins.
Thank you, Michael. Hi, everyone. Thank you for joining us on this session. My name is Edward So. I'm a partner at White & Case based in New York. I sit in the capital markets group specializing in derivatives. So we assist clients on both transactional and derivatives regulatory matters across all asset class, including digital assets. Some of our work include assisting clients setting up a swap trading platform based on digital assets, and then addressing all the broker dealers, the securities law, swap dealers, security-based swap dealers, and bank regulatory issues. I'm joined here today by a few of my colleagues, and I'll let them introduce themselves. Let's start with Christina.
Thanks, Ed. My name is Christina Freudenberger. I'm a partner in the Frankfurt capital market practice focusing on all types of capital markets products, with a slight focus on debt products and including digital assets, tokenized securities, etc. Over to you, Greg.
Great. And Gregoire?
Yeah, good morning, everyone. So my name is Grégoire Carilla. I'm a partner based in Paris. I started my career 20 years ago as an in-house counsel at Deutsche Bank before joining a private practice. I'm in charge of capital markets financings and derivatives with a focus on regulatory capital for financial institutions and fintechs. And I also specialize in digital assets in older forms. Thanks.
Great. Thanks, Gopal. And then I'm joining the room with my colleague, Rhys.
Hello, everyone. My name's Rhys Bortignon, and I'm a derivatives counsel here in New York. I work very closely with Ed and the other derivatives, as well as capital markets partners here.
Great, thank you, Reese. And thank you again for joining us. So digital assets have certainly had a very eventful year. It was another, I guess, other than 1 year ago that there's about an FIA's session on digital assets, it's also almost a year ago that FTX, the second largest cryptocurrency exchange at the time, filed for bankruptcy, which also marked the crypto market capitalization reaching its lowest point in 2 years. But we have now seen a little bounce back, which is great. It's climbing back to mid-2021 level. But during this time, we've also seen heightened focus by regulators to take a more heavy-handed approach on the market. The EU and the US have taken very differing approaches, with the US mainly seek to rely on existing securities, banking, and derivatives regulatory frameworks, and the US regulators to the fear of many have been using enforcement actions to convey the views as to how these rules would apply. In contrast, the EU has implemented new regulatory frameworks that are specifically tailored for digital assets. In particular, the European Council adopted the Markets in Crypto Assets, MiCA regulation, just earlier this year. So we'll spend the remaining time of this hour to quickly highlight some of the key differences between the EU and the US approach on digital asset regulation. We'll be focusing on mainly four areas: classification, issuance, trading, and custody. Conscious that we don't have too much time, but we definitely do welcome questions. If you have any questions, type them in the chat and we'll try to address them at the very end. With that, I now hand it over to Christina, who will help us level set and give us an intro on MiCA and its classification regime.
Yes, thank you. Let me maybe start off by speaking about what the European Market in Crypto Asset Regulation, short MiCA, is and why it is actually there. It has been enacted to close the regulatory gap in the European Union that existed with regard to the issuance, the distribution, and the trading of crypto assets. We've had legislation in place for a while with regard to the issuance, the distribution, and trading of securities that had been harmonized throughout the European Union. We, however, didn't have a comparable regime for crypto assets until very recently. So as a result, EU member states, just until recently, might have or might not have regulated crypto assets on a national level. In any event, if an issuer wanted to issue crypto assets and offer them in different member states or provide custody services, that meant he would have to comply with 27 potentially different national crypto laws. So the clear intention of MiCA is therefore to replace those individual regulations found within the member states and put an end to this regulatory fragmentation by enacting one unifying and comprehensive framework that creates legal certainty for issuers and service providers, while obviously at the same time making sure that consumer protection is guaranteed at a very high level. So while this webinar is actually about MiCA, I think we first need to speak about MiFID. The reason is that digital assets in the EU are regulated both through MiCA as well as MiFID. And in order to understand the scope of application of MiCA, we need to draw the line on the scope of application of MiFID. So MiCA entered into force on 29 June of this year, and we'll look into that in more detail later. As I said, it serves to close the regulatory gap and therefore only applies where EU financial market law, in particular MiFID, does not already regulate digital assets or services related thereto. Okay. So what types of digital assets are regulated by MiCA and what types are regulated by MiFID? MiFID applies to all digital assets that qualify as financial instruments, and these include in particular, transferable securities, irrespective of the form of representation. I.e., in case of a bond that's in tokenized form that is transferred via distributed ledger technology, such bond, even though it's in digital form, qualifies as a financial instrument within the meaning of MiFID. And as a result, the issuance, the placement, the custody, the trading of such tokenized bond, it's all regulated by MiFID and the legislation annexed thereto, such as the prospectus regulation, for instance, when it comes to the public offer of bonds. MiCA then applies to all entities involved in the issuance, public offering, and admission to trading of crypto assets in the European Union, as well as all entities that provide services in relation to such crypto assets, where such issuance or service is not already regulated by MiFID. So given that basically any activity related to crypto assets will in the future be regulated by MiCA, it's crucial to understand what those crypto assets regulated by MiCA actually are. There's a definition included in MiCA, and it defines a crypto asset as a digital representation of a value or of a right that is able to be transferred and stored electronically using distributed ledger technology or similar technology. MiCA makes it then even more specific by breaking down those crypto assets into three different types of assets. One, e-money tokens, two, asset reference tokens, and three, crypto assets, or other crypto assets, actually. So e-money token pursuant to MiCA are defined as a type of crypto asset that purports to maintain a stable value by referencing the value of one official currency. Whereas asset reference token are defined as a type of crypto asset that is not an electronic money token and that aims to maintain a stable value by referencing another value or a combination thereof, including one or more official currencies. Okay, so apparently e-money token as well as asset reference token reference fiat currency. And I think it only becomes clearer at second sight that there is a difference between those two. So an e-money token is actually pegged to one single fiat currency, whereas an asset reference token can reference more than one asset, which can be fiat, but can also be other assets. Both definitions really capture different types of stable coins. In each case, the regulation further distinguishes between normal tokens and significant tokens. And asset reference token and e-money token are considered significant tokens if they reach certain thresholds. And they then require supervision by the European Banking Authority. As a last category, MiCA includes other crypto assets in its scope of application. These other assets include, in particular, cryptocurrencies and utility token. But since MiCA aims to regulate also the issuance of crypto assets, the regulator made it clear that in case of crypto assets that are provided in a fully decentralized manner, such assets do not fall within the scope of application of MiCA. So what does this mean precisely? Well, Bitcoin, for instance, may be the most famous example of a fully decentralized cryptocurrency, is actually not captured by the scope of application of MiCA. And I think that makes perfect sense with regard to the issuance of Bitcoin, because if there's no issuer, there's no entity that you can attach any obligations to, right? However, what's quite interesting, I think, is that MiCA excludes such types of assets like Bitcoin entirely from its scope of application. So even, you know, custody services, trading, etc., with regard to Bitcoin, the regulation doesn't really apply to. And last but not least, let me maybe say what's also explicitly excluded from the scope of application of MiCA, as mentioned before, financial instruments according to MiFID. E-money is an own category pursuant to another European directive, and deposits as well as non-fungible tokens, NFTs. Those are also explicitly exempt, at least as long as they are non-fungible. So, I mean, obviously there is the possibility that NFTs are divided into fractional parts, and it is most likely that MiCA will then apply to those NFTs, although there's no official guidance on that yet. Next slide, please. Thank you. So what will be happening from here on? Well, MiCA entered into force end of June this year. The first set of provisions becomes applicable in summer of 2024, and MiCA will be fully applicable by end of 2024. In addition, as it's quite typical for EU regulation, as you probably know, the European Commission will adopt delegated acts within 36 months from MiCA entering into force that will further specify the content of the existing regulation. In addition, the European Banking Authority and the European Supervisory Authority will also adopt technical standards specifying requirements of MiCA. And on top of that, there will be national legislation specifying the supervisory framework within which the relevant national competent authority operates. Just as an example, Germany, for instance, has just published the Crypto Market Supervision Act, and that bundles the supervisory powers of our competent authority over crypto assets and crypto asset service providers in one law. And with that, I hand it back to my colleagues in New York.
Thank you. Thank you, Christina. So, unlike the EU, the US has not adopted at the federal level any alternative regime for digital assets. In fact, the US regulators have made it clear that the US's existing securities and commodities laws apply to digital assets. And we've seen over the last 12 or so months a significant number of enforcement actions by both the SEC and the CFTC, which has predominantly turned to the investment contract analysis and the factors set in the Howey case to determine whether a particular digital asset is a security. And this is the analysis that they have been using in all, if not most of the recent enforcement actions. And the outcome here is very fact dependent. For example, straight vanilla cryptocurrencies are generally not securities, as they are seen as alternatives to fiat currencies, and the profits are not dependent on the efforts of others. Bitcoin is a prime example of such a cryptocurrency, whereas the classification of other cryptocurrencies, such as Ether, continued to cause some debate. For example, the SEC chair earlier this year declined to say whether or not Ether was a security, whereas the CFTC has seen it as a commodity. Another area of debate is how NFTs are to be treated. Recent SEC enforcement actions have sought to classify these as securities, although these actions ended in settlement without admission by the relevant parties. These actions also elicited strong dissents from some SEC commissioners who questioned whether such actions were an appropriate regulatory response to NFTs and the particular risks that they pose. And this slide is just an example of some of the digital assets that the SEC has considered to be securities over the last sort of 12 or so months. And additionally, when it comes to the SEC's jurisdiction, we also have the security-based swap regime. And the SEC has been clear that if you have a swap referencing a digital asset that is a security, then the SEC's security-based swap regime will apply. The consequences of this is that there are various registration requirements, such as registering as a security-based swap dealer if you have dealing activity over the relevant threshold, as well as margining, clearing, and other obligations that can apply. Okay. So similar to the securities discussion, the CFTC's commodities and derivatives laws do not specifically state whether or not a a particular digital asset is a commodity or otherwise subject to the CFTC's jurisdiction. Therefore, as with the SEC, this needs to be determined on a case-by-case basis, but noting that the definition of commodity is actually very broad. The CFTC's ability to regulate entities in this space is restricted to the swaps, futures, and options industries, and they have more limited jurisdiction over the underlying cash and spot markets. Okay, and with that, we move on to the issuance part of the presentation, and I hand it back to Christina.
Thanks again. The public offering of crypto assets, it's actually subject to quite a sophisticated regulatory regime. The requirements to conduct such public offer vary depending on whether the offer relates to other crypto assets, such as cryptocurrencies and utility token, or asset reference token, or e-money token. What applies to all issuers is the issuer must be a legal entity. There's an obligation to comply with certain rules of conduct, and there's also an obligation to prepare and publish a so-called white paper, which serves as an information document containing mandatory disclosure about the issued crypto asset. And the idea is obviously to inform prospective holders of crypto assets about the characteristics, the functions, the risks of the products that they intend to purchase. It is actually comparable to a security prospectus in many ways, and its contents are also partly based on what we in the European Union are already familiar with from existing securities regulation. What's one of the main differences, though, between an actual prospectus and a financial market regulation and a crypto asset white paper is regulatory approval. So different from a prospectus that needs to be approved by the competent authority prior to publication, a white paper must only be notified to the competent authority and then following this notification be published in order to inform potential buyers. But no rule without an exception. Issuers must not produce or do not need to produce a white paper in case of an offer of crypto assets that's addressed to fewer than 150 natural or legal persons, where the turnover of the offer does not exceed 1 million euro in a 12-month period, or if an offer is addressed exclusively to qualified investors. And those exemptions are actually a really nice example of how MiCA takes inspiration from existing securities regulation, because it's precisely those exemptions that are also the ones that are included in the prospectus regulation and that tell you when a securities prospectus needs to be published for an offer of securities. So despite the requirements of the publication of a white paper and the compliance with certain rules of conduct, let me also quickly mention who may actually issue what type of crypto asset, because there are limitations to that. With regard to other crypto assets, just to recap, those include cryptocurrencies, at least as long as they are not issued fully decentralized, and utility token. The issuer needs to be a legal entity, but no further requirements are stipulated, right? If the issuer intends to issue e-money tokens, the issuer must be licensed as a credit institution or as an e-money institution. In that case, MiCA stipulates certain contact and capital requirements in general, but those do not apply to the issuers of e-money tokens and because those issuers are already licensed credit institutions and subject to the licensing requirements for the respective type of institution, right? So there is no need to actually have this additional regulatory burden. And issuers of asset reference token must either be a legal person that is established in the European Union and that has been explicitly authorized by its competent authority to issue those crypto assets, or it must also be a credit institution. If it's a credit institution, it does not need a special authorization, but must still comply with certain rules. So there is actually not, I think just to recap, there is not anyone can issue those crypto assets. At the very least, you need to be a legal entity, but typically, at least with regard to e-money token, asset reference token, there are additional requirements that are imposed on the issuers. One final thing on the issuance of crypto assets. I mentioned before that there's a difference between normal and significant asset reference tokens and e-money tokens. And it's actually the European Banking Authority that's empowered to designate those type of tokens as either significant or normal tokens. And the criteria to do so are the number of token holders, the number and value of transactions, the value of tokens issued, their connectivity with the financial system, whatever that means. And if that's the case, the issue of such tokens will be subject to additional prudential requirements under MiCA. That includes mandatory liquidity management policy, stress tests, adoption of a remuneration policy that promotes effective risk management. So very, like, if it's actually designated as a significant token, a very high burden to become an issuer of those. And back to you, and Chris.
Okay, moving back to the US. So the offer and sale provisions of US securities laws apply to digital assets that are securities. There is no separate regime. There are no separate exemptions. Digital assets have to comply with the same laws as other securities offerings. In order to have such an issuance, there are various provisions that need to be complied with, including the filing of a registration statement with the SEC, which has to include a prospectus setting out information on business operations, audited financial statements, risk factors, among other items that are required. And the registration statement also needs to include other additional information about some things, including director officer indemnifications, exhibit schedules to the financial statements, and agreements to comply with certain regulatory obligations. This filed prospectus then needs to be made available to investors. And on an ongoing basis, the issuer of the digital asset is subject to ongoing reporting and record keeping requirements, including the filing of forms 10Q, 10K, and if necessary, an 8K. Exemption from these issuance requirements are often limited to professional and non-US investors. And therefore, the application of the US securities laws to digital asset issuances makes it difficult and costly for digital asset securities to be marketed and sold to retail investors. The issuance or dealing in swaps, security-based swaps, futures, and options over or referencing a digital asset may also trigger other registration requirements by the with this SEC and the CFTC. This can include registration as a swap dealer or a security-based swap dealer if there is sufficient dealing activity, registration as a futures commission merchant, and registration as a commodity pool operator or a commodity trading advisor. The entering into of a regulated derivative, whether by this SEC or the CFTC, requires compliance with professional investor qualifications, such as eligible contract participant rules, which exclude the, and as a consequence of these rules, it is not possible to offer most derivatives to retail investors. The CFTC's retail commodity transaction rules do, however, provide a mechanism to offer certain digital asset products to retail investors. But this regime requires the offering to be on a regulated futures exchange. We would also note that these retail commodity transaction rules only apply if actual delivery does not occur within 28 days, which is often significantly longer than most cryptocurrencies take to settle. The CFTC did issue guidance on what actual delivery means in the context of a digital asset, and generally effectively said that their guidance before would also apply to digital assets. And they also, and the CFTC in that guidance also noted that the 28-day exclusion was likely sort of too long with respect to digital assets, which settled much earlier, but they ultimately came to the conclusion that they didn't have the legislative authority to reduce the number of days as it applied to digital assets. Okay. With that, we move to trading, and I will pass it back to my EU colleagues.
Thanks, Rhys. So my colleague Christina gave an overview of the crypto assets qualifications and the obligations of the issuers thereof and the EU law, and I'm going to focus on the financial services relating to crypto assets and crypto asset service providers, or CASP. So CASP need to apply for a license under MiCARP in order to be able to provide such services. And they will have to meet fit and proper and governance requirements, including prudential requirements, such as a minimum capital of 50,000 to 150,000 euros, depending on the type of assets. And they will also have prudential safeguards equal to one quarter of the fixed overhead of the preceding year. There are certain exemptions and grandfathering regimes for existing electronic money institutions and MiFID firms. But today I'm going to focus on the services more than the licensing. So those services include custody and administration of crypto assets, which we will touch upon later in the presentation, and trading related services. So they include advice and portfolio management, exchange of crypto assets for funds or other crypto assets, execution of orders on behalf of clients, and reception and transmission of orders. So first, on advice and portfolio management. Advice is defined as a personalized recommendation in respect of transactions relating to crypto assets or the use of crypto asset services. In contrast to portfolio management, advice includes a personalized recommendation given to the client by the CASP. And portfolio management, on the other hand, means managing portfolios in accordance with mandates given by clients on a discretionary basis, where such portfolios include one or more crypto assets. So that's a very broad definition and covers situations where the client portfolios includes crypto assets, potentially among other asset classes, which means that asset managers providing discretionary portfolio management will be considered to provide a crypto asset service as soon as they purchase any crypto assets on behalf of the client and in line with investment guidelines. Next slide, please. So this slide outlines the different regimes applicable to advice and portfolio management. In the case of advice, the client must be informed in advance of the nature of the advice, whether it's independent or not, as different requirements may apply. For advice and portfolio management alike, MiCAR requires a suitability assessment, very much like the suitability assessment under MiFID. and the provision of a report on the suitability test carried out. In the case of independent advice, a selection must be made from a sufficiently diverse range of products just to ensure objectivity and independence. MiCA also includes a ban on benefits, except under strict conditions where the benefit enhances the quality of the service to clients. Under EU law, benefits are any kind of monetary or benefits-taking other forms that are paid by third parties and that could potentially influence the manager's decision. Furthermore, institutions that engage in portfolio management must issue periodic statements. And lastly, there are provisions on cost transparency and risk warnings. The staff, investment advisors, and sales staff must also be specifically trained and have competence and expertise requirements. Next slide, please. So the following service is the exchange service. MiCA described the exchange of crypto assets as the conclusion of contracts with clients concerning the purchase or sale of crypto assets for funds or for other crypto assets by using proprietary capital. The exchange of crypto assets is characterized by a service element, as the firm engages in such activity for its client, as opposed to entering into the transaction for its own account. The exchange of crypto assets requires the establishment of a non-discriminatory commercial policy, including client criteria. Then the institutions are obliged to publish a firm price of the crypto assets or a method for determining such price. MiCA contains a slippage ban, which means that the client orders have to be executed at the prices displayed at the time when the order is passed. And finally, information such as transaction volume and prices have to be published in relation to the transactions. So transparency requirements. Then on the next slide, we'll talk about execution of client orders, which is defined as the conclusion of agreements on behalf of clients to subscribe, purchase, or sell one or more crypto assets. This means that the clients give the CASP an order for a transaction and the institution executes it on the primary or secondary market. The CASP has to provide an order execution policy and obtain the client's prior consent for the provision of the service, as well as its consent for the execution of orders outside of trading platforms, as the case may be. And the CASP has an obligation of best execution based on the execution policy. Once again, very similar to what we have for financial instruments. Then to finish on services, next slide, please. I will talk about the reception and transmission of client orders, which is the reception from a client of an order to purchase or subscribe or sell one or more crypto assets and the transmission of that order to a third party for execution. For that service, MiCA requires the establishment of procedures and arrangements for prompt and proper transmission, and also contains a ban on payments for order flow, which means that receiving a remuneration from third parties for the transmission of client orders is prohibited. Further, front running is banned, which means that CASPs are not allowed to misuse information relating to pending client orders. Lastly, and does not appear on the slides, but I wanted to mention the operation of a trading platform for crypto assets, which is also a service subject to licensing. So it is defined as a multilateral system which brings together or facilitates the bringing together of multiple third-party purchasing and selling interests in the system and in accordance with its rules, in a way that results in a contract, either by exchanging crypto assets for funds or for other crypto assets. So that's really the definition of a multilateral trading facility. MiCAR provides that the operator has to set non-discretionary rules to ensure fair and orderly trading and objective criteria for the efficient execution of orders, which is similar once again to the requirements of operations of MTFs or OTFs under MiFID. Interestingly, MiCAR also provides for a set of market abuse provisions with the concept of inside information, prohibition of insider dealing and market manipulation that resembles MAR obligations in relation to financial instruments. Now we'll leave the floor to Riz and Ed to discuss US rules on trading.
Thank you, Gregoire. Digital asset security interest issuances subject of recent SEC enforcement have included complaints that the trading of these assets triggered some or all of the registration requirements that you see on this slide. Additionally, the trading and dealing in swaps on digital asset securities would also trigger registration, clearing, and margin requirements for security-based swaps, such as registration as a security-based swap execution facility. And I would note that the SEC in the last week or so has finalized rules on the use and establishment of security-based swap execution facilities. The SEC has noted that the various trading services provided by digital asset issuers, notwithstanding the differences in technology as compared with traditional securities and derivatives trading, nonetheless requires registration with the Commission. The consequences of registration vary depending on which entity you are registering as, but generally, these requirements can include capital requirements, customer protection and business conduct standards, record keeping and reporting requirements, conflicts of interest rules, and examinations by the SEC and self-regulatory organizations. And as mentioned previously and on other slides, there are no specific exemptions or rules with respect to the digital asset industry. As we move to the CFTC's jurisdiction and over commodities and derivatives, the view that they have expressed is that digital asset trading is subject to registration requirements under their rules, including registration as CEFs, DCMs, and FCMs. The CFTC's enforcement actions have also included alleged violations of the CFTC's anti-manipulation and anti-fraud rules. These separate rules apply to all market participants, not just entities registered with the CFTC, such as a CEF DCM or an FCM. And the scope of these rules is broad and includes both the derivatives markets and, in some instances, the cash markets, particularly where the cash markets are used to improperly impact or affect the related futures options or swaps markets. We'll now move to the final part of our presentation, which relates to custody, and I will hand back to my colleague Gregoire.
Thank you, Rhys. This slide is a recap of the main crypto asset services. So far, we have discussed all of them, save for custody and administration. This service is often overlooked, and it's not necessarily considered as offering a lot of value added from a commercial standpoint, but the legal certainty of the title of the crypto asset and also the financial solidity of the custodian are among the main concerns of the investors these days. Next slide, please. Custody and administration of crypto assets are defined as safekeeping and controlling on behalf of clients of crypto assets of the means of access to crypto assets such as private cryptographic keys. So first, in the client relationship, the institution has to enter into a custody agreement with the client. Then it will keep a register of positions opened in the name of each client, corresponding to each client's rights to the crypto assets. The institution establishes a custody policy with internal rules and procedures to ensure the safekeeping and minimize the risk of loss of clients' crypto assets, as well as an insolvency-proof custody with inverted comma, because it's probably not as strong as that, but an insolvency-proof custody by segregating clients' assets from their own. In the case of loss of crypto assets, interestingly, the institution is legally liable by principle, which is essentially a reversal of the burden of proof for the benefit of the client. The institution would only be able to lift its liability if it is able to demonstrate that the loss occurred independently from the provision of the custody service. It has nothing to do with it. And finally, outsourcing is possible, but must comply with strict requirements of MiCA. And now I will hand back to Riz and Ed on the US side.
Thank you, Bukwa. So in the US, on the custody side, regulators are largely following the same theme as in the other areas and rely on existing rules. So for example, in the immediate aftermath of the FTX bankruptcy, the three major federal banking regulators in the US, namely the Federal Reserve, the FDIC, and the OCC, issued a joint statement on the crypto asset risk to banking organizations. So in the statement, while the bank regulators actually specifically called out, and I'll quote, legal uncertainties related to custody practices, end quote, as a risk factor, the bank regulator simply concluded by reminding banks of the general safety and soundness requirement and, quote, to comply with applicable laws and regulations, including those designed to protect customers, end quote. So basically, while follow the existing rules, we noticed that there are legal uncertainties relating to custody practice, but we are not kind of issuing any specific rules to guide you. But because of the novel technology involved, the existing custody rules do not really work quite well with digital assets. Even as early as 2021, the SEC was confronted with such an issue because under the SEC's customer protection rule, rule 15C33, a broker-dealer has to maintain the physical possession or control of all fully paid securities. Well, the issue is, what is physical possession or control in this in the realm of digital assets? There, the SEC make a surgical cut and then just put a Band-Aid on it. The SEC issued a temporary relief that allows a broker-dealer to completely ignore the physical possession or control rules if that broker-dealer is a special purpose broker-dealer that only deals with digital assets. Basically, the SEC created a regime where, well, if you're a broker-dealer, but all you do is digital assets, you won't be able to contaminate this the securities world. In that digital asset world, I will let you ignore the possession and control. So they didn't really kind of come up with a regime to govern that. Rather, they isolated and try to cut it off. It's temporary because that relief is scheduled to expire 5 years from 2021, so it's coming up in April 2026. Well, as part of the FTX fallout, SEC recently proposed a rule to modify the existing Investment Advisors Act rule on the safe custodying of client assets. So currently, Rule 20642 would deem it a fraudulent, deceptive, or manipulative practice, which is quite serious, for a registered investment advisor to have custody of their client's funds or securities, unless it is with a qualified custodian. Qualified custodian is pretty straightforward, basically regulated entities such as bank, trust, broker dealers. But there are some open questions. The open questions would be, well, are digital asset funds, are they under the custody rule at all? And what is control established over a non-physical assets? And then there is also some question as to whether a custodian of the investment advisor, if they go into bankruptcy, is it clear enough as to whether or not the digital assets will be excluded from the bankruptcy estate of this custodian? So in earlier this year, the SEC proposed a rule to amend the custody rule under the Investment Advisors Act. So the first thing it does is to expand the scope of what needs to be held as a qualified custodian. The new terminology, instead of funds and securities, it's funds, securities, or other positions held in the client's account. And specifically in the proposal, the SEC made it clear that this phrase is meant to capture digital assets, which means digital assets now need to be held as a qualified custodian. And then it went on to try to define what possession or control means. And what it ended up doing was it ties that into control. Control would mean the custodian needs to participate in any change of beneficial ownership of that digital asset. So if you can imagine, if the custodian has the private keys to the digital asset, obviously the custodian would need to be required to participate for any kind of change in control of that digital asset. That works in the simple case. What is problematic with this phraseology, as pointed out by many commentators, is the concept of beneficial ownership. Because, well, even when we deal with the simplest securities, beneficial ownership is pretty hard to establish. Because, well, if I have a swap on a security, do I now have beneficial ownership of the underlying security? If I have, and similarly, if we have a swap on the digital asset, well, I could have beneficial ownership of the underlying digital asset, but the custodian that's actually holding the digital assets may not have the ability to participate in the swap, which actually would change the hands of the beneficial ownership. So it's an attempt to kind of clarify and define terms to make the existing rules work with digital assets, but it's not quite there yet. And then in terms of clarifying the bankruptcy point, it's almost unrelated to digital assets, but it will say, well, custodian, you need to recognize that you're holding it for customers and agree not to contaminate the other kind of assets and liability of the custodian. So in a contractual sense, and in the US bankruptcy code, these type of contract language may or may not work unless there's a change in the code. So that's also remain to be seen. So again, this is really just a rule proposal, heavily commented on by the market participants right now. Lastly, I wanted to at least mention that when we talk about the US regulations, we have been focusing on the federal rules, CFTC rules, and SEC rule. There are also state regulations that are relevant, and many of you have already heard of the New York's BIT license regime, which has been around since 2015. Earlier this year, California passed a set of very similar rules. These regimes are actually quite comprehensive because they will govern almost every aspect of what we just mentioned, the classification, issuance, trading, and custody. The problem with the state regime is that while we don't have a very robust federal regime, it is questionable whether or not the federal regime will trump the state regime, which means we probably, for now, have to comply with of the state's individual regimes and the federal regime, and they may disagree with one another, treat digital assets differently. At a minimum, they would treat digital assets differently because these state rules, both New York and California, goes into great length to actually define what is it that they're regulating. So in the California law, that's digital finance asset business activity. And then it goes into what that means. And as Reese has mentioned many, many times on the federal side, we don't really actually define for you what digital assets actually mean. So the issue is, of course, also in California, they granted some reciprocity to a New York licensed entity, but it's only the case if that entity was licensed before January 2023. So, which means going forward, at least for now, entities will have to be dually licensed. I know we're a little bit short on time, and thank you for everyone's attention so far. We have a couple minutes to answer some questions. I know that we have received some questions already. One particular on Mika. Christina or Gregor, if you have that question, do you want to address that?
Yeah, maybe I'll try to start. So for the benefit of everyone, the question is, would token market making be covered by MiCA? That's a good question. I don't recall having seen any specific reference to market making in the regulation. However, we are still waiting for measures to be taken and technical standards to be adopted. So maybe this will be dealt with specifically, but I guess that at least in the current state of the legislation, you still need to comply with the so-called market abuse safeguards, and you should avoid in engaging in any kind of transaction that would constitute a market manipulation. But otherwise, regular market making should probably be feasible right now. I don't know, Christina, if you want to say something.
Fully agree, Gregoire. Nothing to add.
Okay. I think we have a minute or two if there's any other questions. We type it in the question box. If not, well, this concludes our webinar, and we're very happy to have the opportunity to speak with you. We're happy to speak with you offline if you have any other further questions. I wanted to take this opportunity to actually thank our associate, Al Kostomi, provided tremendous assistance in putting this presentation together in the background, literally, because she's actually in the room and off camera. We wanted to also thank the FIA for the opportunity to speak with you all today and look forward to speaking with you all on this and other topics in the future. And with that, I'll hand it back to Michael.
Thanks, Ed and team. We really appreciate you joining today and giving us the lay of the land across continents on digital assets. Quick reminder, if you're looking for CLE and you joined for the entirety of the program, Beth will be sending you a certificate shortly. We will post a recording of the webinar here. So if after seeing it, you think colleagues or other folks in your shop might be interested, they can view it at their leisure. And just our next webinar will be December 14th. It will cover the supervision rules. It will be hosted by Wilkie Farr. And as a further teaser, we expect to have a rep on from the CFTC for that program. So thanks all again for joining. I hope to see you all soon.